Hello and welcome back to the YouTube Iceberg. You guys already know the drill at this point, so let's just get right into it. What's Inside is a YouTube channel run by father and son duo Dan and Lincoln Markham. They operate under a similar format to Will It Blend, as they cut into random objects and then show and explain to everyone what's inside of them. The channel started in 2014 as part of then 8-year-old Lincoln's second grade school project, and since then they just kept uploading videos cutting into more things. A wasp nest, a fidget spinner, a bowling ball, a YouTube play button, his son. That last one really happened, by the way. The channel's family-friendly content has gotten very popular over the years, reaching over 7 million subscribers. Zone Toons, commonly referred to as just Zone, is an animator who makes porn of children's cartoons. They're most well-known for their videos, often being extremely accurate to the original show's art style. Kind of like a Mr. Davy, only for porn, I guess. Well, recently they got a lot of attention from the Anka video you've probably seen cropped somewhere. The thing that got them the most popularity is their My Life as a Teenage Robot parody called What What in the Robot, uploaded to Newgrounds in 2010. It's porn. Not much else to say there, it's just porn. It at one point was on YouTube and then got removed because it's fucking porn. Like, what did you expect? Ghost Car refers to this 20-second video released in July 2005 by user Mr. Smithereen. You've probably seen this before. The car drives through the valley while common music plays, and then a weird zombie thing jumps in front of the screen and starts screaming. The video was originally produced by a German coffee company known as Kaffee for use as a commercial, with the idea being that when you're scared shitless by the jump scare at the end, it will accurately simulate how it feels to drink their coffee. It'll make you feel really animated and alive, I guess. Alongside Scary Maze Game, Ghost Car is one of the earliest and most iconic screamers out there. Kaffee actually produced a lot more commercials than just this one, with all of them following pretty much the same format, but Ghost Car was by far the most famous one because of its early re-upload to YouTube. DK Rap 2018 is a video created by Brentalfloss. It's a parody of the DK Rap from Donkey Kong 64, and it shows the viewer where all the Kongs went after the game's release. Donkey Kong got really into guns, Tiny Kong started killing bees, Diddy Kong turned into an incel, and Chunky Kong is dead. Mildly popular video, but I feel like this entry should be dedicated to everything else Brentalfloss has on the site, mainly his With Lyrics series, where he sings lyrics over video game songs, which is a series that's been going on since 2008. He was one of the first YouTubers I ever was a fan of, at an age where I definitely should not have been watching his videos, so I think he deserves a special shoutout. Shrek is Love, Shrek is Life is a copypasta that circulated around 2013 of a green text about a 9-year-old boy who prays to Shrek before bed, before getting molested when he walks into the room. The copypasta quickly gained notoriety with the release of dramatic readings by channels like Catalyst EXE and Sergeant Snugglebutt. There are also a set of animations to go along with the dramatic readings that were made by a now deleted user named Psychotic in Source Filmmaker. This copypasta and the videos to go along with it are a big part of the reason why the internet was so obsessed with Shrek in 2013 and 2014. My Clumsy Best Man Ruins Our Wedding, sometimes known as Bride Falls in Pool, is a video of a wedding where the best man, while bringing the ring for the groom to give to the bride, trips and falls, pushing the bride into a pool of water that's, for some reason, right behind the wedding reception. It was a popular viral video, popular enough for the couple to be invited on the Fox News show Good Day LA, although in reality, the clip was fake and the couple were never actually married, and instead the video was a promotion for the film Chloe and Keith's Wedding. The film was a found footage type deal in a similar style to movies like The Blair Witch Project and Paranormal Activity. Found footage is usually used for horror movies to give a sense of realism to make it more scary, although director Archie Gipps uses it for a comedy film instead. This results in free marketing from people who think it's real, which actually worked pretty well since the clip was played on The Ellen Show, Good Morning America, and The Today Show. Talking Kitty Cat was a channel created by a man named Steve Cash in 2007. In these videos, he would record his cats, and whenever they opened their mouths, he would edit the video to have them appear to be talking. He had six pets named Sylvester, Gibson, Shelby, Random Kitty, Gibbyson, and Gigi. There'd be tons of videos in the series with him characterizing the pets with different personalities and, oddly enough, even plot lines. The channel had over 3 million views and was a massive success. However, Steve dealt with bipolar disorder, which would cause him to go months without uploading, and tragically, he died by self-inflicted gunshot in 2020. The main and oldest cat on the channel, Sylvester, also died soon after. It's really sad how such a kind person had to go like this. The channel is still active, but it's just his wife posting unused content that he couldn't get to upload before he died. Too Many Cooks is a short film directed by Casper Kelly and produced on Adult Swim in 2014. It's a parody of sitcom openings like Friends or That 70s Show, and for 11 minutes they keep adding a comical amount of characters. The short also switches genres partway through, like at one point it's this 80s looking superhero cartoon, another part it's a crime drama, another it's this Star Trek-ass sci-fi setting. There's also this murderer guy who shows up halfway through that keeps murdering all the characters and then eating their bodies, and at one point the names switch places with the people. It has over 22 million views, and as I mentioned in Tier 1, its own font for the title of the video as a little Easter egg created by the YouTube staff. Over the years, Javed's cinematic masterpiece, Me at the Zoo, has had its description hijacked multiple times. One time, in September of 2019, the description was hacked to read sub to sub, K thanks bye, fast and loyal, if not, I get a subs back, I will unsubs your channel. We don't know who this was, other than it was someone who didn't know how to spell channel, and also apparently didn't know it was supposed to be sub for sub, not sub to sub. Another time, someone added part 2 here, and it led to a rickroll. Another time, there was a fake fundraiser that said part 2 would be posted if they got $1 million. Another person said there'd be a part 2 at 10 million subscribers. You know, I'm noticing a common thread of some kind of sequel to Me at the Zoo, but more on that in a while. Blank character sliding in was a trend on Niko Niko Douga and soon YouTube that dates back to 2009 with this animation of the Toho character Chen sliding into a box while music from Monster Hunter Freedom Unite plays. The video was actually originally referenced to this video of Maru the Cat. The format was soon parodied with characters from other series, and of course eventually the brony fandom got a hold of it, with numerous different takes on ponies sliding into a box. There's one in particular created by Two Snacks, with the title being Kugi no Hako, or Box of Nails. And, well.
Oh shit!
Chad Warden is, for one, the fucking goat, and also one of the first and most infamous trolls in YouTube history. He was the online persona of a man named Anthony Pinto, and would often talk about how good the PlayStation 3 is, and how much worse the Xbox and Wii were. He would often flex how rich he is and stated that $600 isn't shit to a guy like Chad Warden. This video was uploaded in 2007 in the heat of the 7th gen console wars, and he received tons of angry comments and video responses, which was obviously his goal. He made a second video where he showed off his Cadillac and comical amount of $100 bills in response to those who said he was lying about being rich, and a third where he continues talking about how lame the Wii is, saying that Mario Party needs more drugs, and Smash Bros. Brawl should add Tupac and Biggie, and that PS Triple games are ABAP.
That PS Triple stresses ABAP. I don't know y'all niggas know what ABAP means. ABAP means as baller as possible.
After these videos, most people began to realize he was a troll, and he gained a massive fan base. He also became intertwined with the YouTube poop community, as they were gaining popularity around the same time he was. In 2008, he randomly dropped off the face of the internet, only being seen afterwards at conventions and at one Smash tournament. The Chad Warden legacy will live on, however, as he still gets references today, like how he was a huge part of Siva Gunner lore. Scatman John was a musician who gained popularity in the 1990s through his many albums, especially the Scatman's World album that sold over 1 million copies. Sadly though, he passed away in 1999 at age 57 due to lung cancer, though his popularity did not die down as the music video for Scatman Skid Ba Bop Ba Da Bop gained over 150 million views on YouTube years later. The song's message is about how Scatman John suffered a chronic stutter for his entire life, and in spite of this, he became an incredibly influential artist, and the song is about how if the Scatman can do it, then so can you. Several of his other songs have also become popular on the internet, being used in memes, YouTube poops, and even background music for Windows Movie Maker videos. And this wasn't even an audio swap, so if it was commonly used in Windows Movie Maker videos, that's how you know it's good. Bart Kills Barney is a 12-second clip that's honestly fucked up and demented. Barney starts singing the I Love You song to Bart, and he pulls out a gun and shoots him. And then a troll comes out and laughs at his corpse. The sick and twisted fucking bastard who made this video is apparently named Kate Wilson, and she made it in 2008. There's not much else to say here. Bart Killed Barney. Yeah, I already went over this. Go watch part one, I guess. I don't know. Here It Goes Again is a song by the rock band OK Go, released in 2006. The music video in particular was what got it the most attention, as it features the group dancing on a bunch of treadmills. It's one continuous shot and apparently took 17 attempts to get right. It got 60 million views and was one of the first big music videos to get popular on YouTube. Cute Things Exploding is a channel about cute things exploding. They basically just take some cute viral video of a cat or something and edit it so they explode. Most of their videos were uploaded in 2009 and they stopped uploading in 2012, only to come back in 2022 to upload Baby Bunny Exploding and Young Cat Exploding. While browsing videos on YouTube, you may notice this free tag that shows up for some reason. What the free tag is used for is to indicate when something you usually have to pay for is available free of charge. Sometimes it's a free movie, or maybe it's a YouTube premium series where you get to watch one episode for free. Although a lot of the time it's just old YouTube videos, like PewDiePie videos or something. We don't actually know why this happens, other than it probably has something to do with YouTube premium, and the glitch has since been patched out. Sammy Classic Sonic Fan is a YouTuber who is most infamous for his rant videos about Sonic the Hedgehog, posted in 2014 when he was only 15 years old. His most popular video, and the one to gain him the most amount of notoriety, was Stop Hating on Sonic, where he was very angry and outspoken about those who would sully the Sonic name. His videos were probably the most common to show up in cringe compilations, as his rants were often hard to follow due to the incredibly common voice cracks, frequent quote-unquote profanity, which is really just him saying frick, and also just how angry he got. He was very clearly passionate about the subject matter. His style of ranting was most likely inspired by other rant commentary type YouTubers who were popular at the time. You know, people like Blackbuster Critic, Ben the Looney, and especially Mario to Plumber. Sammy eventually had his channel deleted, allegedly by his parents. He's had many different channels, including Sammy Classic Sonic Fan, Sammy Tanuki Gamer, Sammy Harbors, Multi Mario Sonic, Snoopy Flying Ace 64, Sammy Paper Mario Fan, Sammy Space Time, Sammy The Classic Sonic Fan, and the imperishable Sammy Zenith. His attention online led to bouts of depression, which, I mean, the kid was fucking 15 and at the time was getting almost as much attention as Chris Chan. However, as time went on, he proved to grow up and become his own man. He still shows up on YouTube and Instagram on occasion, but it seems he's moved past the frickin' frick days of his youth. FGTV is a channel aimed at young audiences run by a family of two parents, four kids, and two dogs. They produce mainly gaming videos based around popular children's content at the time, like, you know, Roblox, Poppy Playtime, Hello Neighbor, Skylanders, stuff like that. They've been around since 2013 and are quite popular with their target demographic with over 20 million subscribers. They have several alternative accounts like Fun Null Vision and FV Family, which are both vlogging channels. Not much else to say here, it's just your average gaming channel aimed at kids. Sometimes it's kind of funny because you'll see people that are definitely past the target demographic saying that this channel quote-unquote fell off when, like, no, you just got too old for it. I I've been mentioning Movie Maker a lot in this tier, but let's talk for a second about what I mean. Windows Movie Maker, as you probably know, is a discontinued video editing software that came packaged with releases of Windows XP, Windows Vista, and Windows 7. Thanks to the fact that it was easy to use and pretty much every little kid had access to it, unless, God forbid, they use... I don't even want to say it. Windows Movie Maker was a pretty popular choice for editing videos. It was everywhere, despite being very limited in the things you could do with it. This led pretty much every video made by smaller YouTubers to look the exact same, especially given the fact that unregistered Hypercam and AudioSwap music were also disproportionately common at this time. Nowadays, Microsoft no longer supports Movie Maker, but people will still download older versions of it for ironic purposes. What the Fuck Boom is an iconic meme of the mid to late 2000s. What the fuck? The origin of it is actually a mix of a couple different sources, since the beeping noise is from Counter-Strike, the what the fuck is from the Steve Mustache Show, and the explosion noise is from Mega 64. The original mashup of these sounds was from a YTMND page of Ocarina of Time Link opening up a chest and finding a bomb, followed by the iconic sound clip. This YTMND is still up to this day and has been reused in countless YouTube poops. Crushin' Obama was a music video produced by BarelyPolitical.com in 2007 during a Barack Obama's presidential campaign. Model Amber Lee Ettinger lip-synced to vocals provided by singer Leah Kaufman. In the video, she seductively sings about how attractive she finds Barack Obama. Got over 25 million views, and Obama's campaign had to publicly issue a statement that they had nothing to do with the production of the video. Animator vs. Animation is a web series created by Alan Becker that started all the way back in 2007. The story follows a stick figure who was drawn on Flash by a mouse cursor, and the mouse eventually begins to start torturing him, and the stick figure fights back. Then there was Animator vs. Animation 2, then 3, each one ramping up in quality. And after a 3-year hiatus, a Kickstarter was posted for Animator vs. Animation 4, which was very well made, and from there on, Animator vs. Animation became a long-running series with multiple different spin-off series, such as Animation vs. Minecraft, Animation vs. YouTube, and eventually Animator vs. Animation 5, which, in my opinion, is one of the greatest and most creative videos ever released on the website. Seriously, I'm not even going to show any footage of the fifth part. Please just go watch the series if you haven't. I can't recommend it enough. Video games in real life are basically these sketch comedy videos where people act out so-called game logic in real life, making stunning observations like, if Mario punched a brick in real life, it would hurt, or Link shouldn't break pots, someone owns those. Definitely the most prolific creator of these kinds of videos, and possibly the pioneer, was Smosh, although other creators have done similar videos. This entry refers to a video uploaded by Mike Matei of Cinemassacre fame. Yes, Cinemassacre as in Angry Video Game Nerd Cinemassacre. Basically, Mike Matei and James Rolfe made a video about the Super Mario Bros. Super Show DVD because they thought it was funny that Inspector Gadget shows up to explain how a DVD menu works, which, to be fair, it was pretty funny. However, this led Mike to take the joke a bit too far, as he made this video called Minecraft with Gadget. In this video, he shows Inspector Gadget what Minecraft is, and the jokes are laughably bad, as well as the Gadget impression. Gadget calls it Minecrafta and Minecrap for some reason, and he talks about how he likes the brown bricks in Minecrap, because, like, the brown bricks are, like, poop, I guess. The video is notoriously bad on all accounts, which has led to people ironically gassing it up, saying it's the greatest thing ever. It's referenced a lot on things like Oni Plays, Siva Gunner, and even fucking Deltarune. There's even a Minecraft with Gadget Iceberg Explained video created by a user named CoolMan6446 for some reason. So if you want more info on the Minecraft with Gadget lore, I would recommend checking that out. Although something tells me that it's not made out of honest, 100% unironic love for the video, but hey, I'm not one to jump to conclusions. Greatest Freakout Ever is a video created by WafflePwn on May 3rd, 2009. In it, a teenager explains that his mom cancels his brother World of Warcraft subscription, and he's just freaking out. We then get a hidden camera view of the brother's room, where he starts throwing his body all over everything, wraps himself up in a blanket, strips down to his underwear, and even attempts to shove a TV remote up his ass for some reason. This video got crazy popular, leading to Greatest Freakout Ever 2, where he rages at a video game or something. Then in Greatest Freakout Ever 3, he freaks out because he got a shitty truck for his birthday and starts beating it with a baseball bat. After 3 came 4, after 4 came 5, there are 44 Greatest Freakout Evers as of September 2022. And you know, I don't think they can all be the greatest freakout evers. Like, at least a couple of them have got to be fake, right? Well, all of them are fake. I mean, like, fucking duh. It was accidentally confirmed by his mother on an internet podcast where they called her home phone looking for an interview. And also, like, duh. Still, Greatest Freakout Ever remains an important piece of internet history and paved the way for series like Psycho Dad and Angry Grandpa. In 2021, YouTube changed every unlisted video uploaded before 2017 to private. On paper, it wasn't too big of a deal since you could just change it back, but since some users who uploaded the videos have left YouTube or the internet in general, or even died, there's definitely some media that's been lost as a result of this change. It's supposed to be like a security change or something? I don't know, they didn't explain it very well. It was just another case of YouTube making their platform more annoying to use. Machinima is a term that can refer to two things on YouTube. The first use was to denote these videos where people would use a video game to create a narrative. They usually provide voices to the characters, and there's generally usually a plot. The most famous of these is probably Red vs. Blue, which has voiceovers of gameplay of Halo Combat Evolved. There are also other popular machinimas like Half-Life VR, but the AI is self-aware, Final Fantasy VII Machinabridged, and SMG4. The other use of Machinima refers to Machinima Inc., an online entertainment network founded in 2000, named after the video format. Originally just a spot to share machinimas, it quickly turned into one of the biggest networks when it went to YouTube in 2006, with their logo being plastered pretty much everywhere. They supported some of the largest creators the site had seen, such as PewDiePie, CNanners, Skydas Minecraft. I mean, it was a lot of people. To be sponsored with Machinima meant signing 3-year contracts where they took 40% of your revenue, which now sounds fucking terrible, but in the late 2000s it was better than what people normally were getting for gaming videos, which was no revenue and risking your channel getting taken down by the game's parent company. Although people began to realize that 3 years is actually a really fucking long time, and a lot of former Machinima partners would be fucked over. As gaming content creation got more and more profitable on YouTube, since you could monetize your gaming videos directly through YouTube rather than using this shitty middleman, a lot of creators still had this giant 3-year Machinima contract-shaped parasite attached to their YouTube careers. There were obviously less and less people signing Machinima contracts as the 2010s progressed, and the need for such a company dwindled, so the company themselves just kept losing more and more money. In 2016, they were bought out by Warner Media, which in turn was bought out by AT&T, and then in 2019, Machinima officially ceased operations after privating every video on the Machinima channel, all 26,500 of them, and that's not even including side channels like Machinima Respawn, Machinima Realm, Machinima Happy Hour, and Machinima Prime. Basically, what I'm getting at is this was the burning of Alexandria for COD montages. While Vocaloid songs like those of Hatsune Miku often sound upbeat and cheery, a lot of them are actually about depression, suicide, and other disturbing topics, such as examples like The Disappearance of Hatsune Miku, which is about Miku being uninstalled or basically dying in Vocaloid terms. There's also a song called Oka-san, which is definitely made with the intention of being creepy, and it's about a little girl being murdered by her mother. There's also Secrets of Wisteria, which is a song that uses the Vocaloid Oliver to sing a song about Albert Fish, who was a real-life serial killer, rapist, child molester, and cannibal. There's tons of these that I definitely couldn't cover in this entry alone, but just know it's a weirdly prominent trend. That Is the Plan was a side channel of Anthony Fantano, a music critic also known as The Needle Drop. On the channel, he would often parody meme review channels like Behind the Meme and talk about internet culture. In 2017, Fantano was accused by magazine The Fader of pandering to the alt-right on his shitpost channel that he had, despite the fact that he's an outspoken liberal that would often make fun of conservative and alt-right talking points on the exact channel they were talking about. This made him delete the channel and make a 20-minute video explaining how he's not alt-right, going point by point on the hit piece and deconstructing each argument. It was just kind of a dumb drama, and everyone knows he's not alt right. Okay, this one on the other hand is a bit... yeah. JonTron, who's an internet comedian, video game and movie reviewer, as well as former Game Grump, has political views that one could say are a bit questionable. In 2016, John defended a tweet from IO representative Steve King, who says that we can't restore our civilization with someone else's babies, stating, "Wow, how scandalous. Steve King doesn't want his country invaded by people who have contempt for his culture and people. Nazi." After this, he agreed to go on the stream of Twitch political commentator Destiny. There, they discussed what he was defending at first, and he said nobody wants to become a minority in their own country. He then went on to say some stuff like European colonialism being a good thing for certain African countries, and that, quote, wealthy blacks commit more crimes than poor whites. All in all, it was very alarming for those who had considered themselves fans. He had a drop in subscribers, not as much as the Fine Bros or Pro Jared, but still pretty noticeable. He left Normal Boots a few months later, although it was apparently unrelated to the controversy. Around the same time, John was to be featured as voice work for two indie games, Yooka-Laylee and Hat in Time. Yooka-Laylee had his voice role replaced, while Hat in Time kept him in. It's a pretty divisive issue, and way more legitimate than whatever the fuck Anthony Fantano shit was. Creepypasta reading channels are exactly what they sound like, channels where people read creepypastas. The most popular example of these is the username Creeps McPasta, who's been on YouTube since 2012, narrating creepypasta stories. One of my personal favorites when I was a kid was a channel called Yuri of Wind, who had a series called Bullshit Creepypasta Storytime, where he narrated dumb creepypastas like Sonic.exe, and talked about how dumb they were. The creepypasta reading channel seemed to have died down a bit, since a lot of YouTubers who used to do it have moved on to other things, like for example, Corpse Husband. Yeah, I was a bit surprised when he didn't spawn into YouTube with the release of Among Us, but I guess he does have the creepypasta narration voice with him. Another prime example is Mudahar from Some Ordinary Gamers, but we'll get to that later down on the iceberg. Either way, they seem to have survived to some extent, as there are tons of videos reading SCP articles or the Backrooms Wiki. Some focus has also shifted away from creepypastas to actual crimes, like, for example, this iceberg later down the line, because Jesus fucking Christ. Ultimate Dog Tease is a video by Andrew Grantham, uploaded in 2011. In the video, he's talking to his dog about how he ate all the meat in the fridge and how his dog can't have any, which makes his dog sad. Not much else to this one, it's just yet another funny video that got popular. Alright, so Newgrounds Animations actually applies to quite a bit of entries I've already talked about, such as Asdiff Movie, Salad Fingers, Ultimate Shredder, Ultimate Destiny, Charlie the Unicorn, Animators Animation, and pretty much all of Hot Diggity Demon's old stuff. Newgrounds is a site created by Tom Fulp that predates even YouTube, and it's dedicated to content creation of all kinds, like music, art, animations, and even games. A lot of animations you've probably seen on older YouTube originate from that site. The Awesome Series, Brawl Taunts, Mario Bros. Z, Ed's World, Madness Combat, Hellbenders, Nintendo, anything by Senor Palo, Oni, Psychic Pebbles, the list goes on and on. Even some popular pieces of media got their start in Newgrounds, like Super Meat Boy, Binding of Isaac, Castle Crashers, and Smiling Friends. YouTube was actually a huge point of contention on Newgrounds in the 2000s, since a lot of people would have their animation re-uploaded with no credit given.
Alright, now all we've got to do is sit back and wait until people put this on YouTube without crediting us.
Oh, come on, Curb. No one would do that.
For the longest time, Newgrounds kind of seemed to have lost the war as more and more animators began uploading their stuff to YouTube. Newgrounds saw a steady decline in traffic, or at least they were seeing a steady decline until a certain blue-haired bastard showed up. Nowadays, Newgrounds is mostly used by artists, 14-year-olds who really like FNF, and porn addicts. Or people that are some combination of all three. Nizotch is the YouTube channel of Marcus Persson, also known as Notch, also known as Minecraft Guy. He joined YouTube in 2008, although sadly all of his videos have been deleted. However, looking at archival channels, we can find that his first video was called Creating Breaking the Tower, which is a time-lapse video of him making a game for the Ludum Dare game jam. His first Minecraft-related video was Cave Game Tech Test, which is an insanely early version of Minecraft. The description reads, "This is a very early test of an InfoMiner clone I'm working on. It'll have more resource management materials if I ever get around to finishing it." Which, yeah, he did do that. It's kind of funny that he called it a clone of InfoMiner, because nowadays, InfoMiner just looks like a clone of Minecraft. I wonder how many abandoned game dev videos there are on YouTube just lying around. Could you imagine if no one noticed his video, and Minecraft never came out? It's kind of crazy to think about. Remy Sit Speak is a video where a woman calls her dog over to sit down and speak. He then barks for her, and nothing vulgar or profane ever happens. Then she calls him a good boy because he didn't swear anything. No, I don't know why you would even think he would swear in the video. Dogs can't even talk. Dumbass. Fake future gen console videos are pretty raw. Basically, there are these movie maker slideshows of images of quote-unquote future consoles that we'll be getting after the current gen that they got off Google Images. These videos were popular around 2008 to 2010, so they're basing it off consoles at the time, such as PlayStation 3, Xbox 360, and Wii. There's a bunch of Xbox 720 designs, which is a better name than we actually got. The Wii had the Wii 2 and Wii Phone. And of course, the PS3 had PS4, which, I mean, yeah, you got that, man. I don't think that's how the controller looks, though. The most popular of these videos is titled Future Gen Consoles Wii 2 PS4 Xbox 720 by a channel called Video Game AF, who apparently now works at Epic Games. Neat. If you look at Javed's account right now in 2022, no videos show up besides me at the zoo. However, that's not to say he's never uploaded anything else. There's a playlist of deleted videos that I'll link in the description that has all of his old videos archived. Looking through this playlist, we can find a video of him rolling down a hill, a couple airplane videos, a reaction video to Numa Numa.
No, not gonna happen.
A video called YouTube Victim, computer-generated animation of water, exploration of an abandoned building, a couple travel videos, a video of his dog Yoda, and a presentation he did about YouTube's growth. Honestly, pretty wide variety of content, and I'm not really sure why he deleted all of these, but I guess having me at the zoo being your only video is pretty cool. Toy Freaks was a YouTube channel that's a classic example of what the whole ElsaGate thing was about. Ran by a single father named Gregory Chisholm, the channel was similar to other ElsaGate channels, but what set this one apart is that he would exploit his two young daughters for views. He would often film the daughters while they were in the bathroom, he would force feed them food and have them spit it back up and pretend like they're babies. There's one video where it looks like one of the girls peed on herself, and apparently, according to the algorithm, this abuse actually worked, even though anyone with a functioning brain could tell that this is literal child abuse. Obviously, it's a little kids channel, and little kids aren't exactly known for their functioning brains. Toy Freaks capped out at 8 million subscribers and 7 billion total views for what should probably be illegal. Do you remember the event known as the Adpocalypse I was talking about in Tier 2, and how I said it was the first of many? Well, the Toy Freaks situation was the second event to be considered an Adpocalypse, as advertisers such as Adidas, Mars, HP, and Deutsche Bank began pulling away from YouTube. YouTube responded by banning Toy Freaks from the site in November of 2017, and in 2018 they updated the policy on the partner program, saying that you're only eligible if you have over 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 watch hours per year, effectively punishing smaller channels for something a channel with 8 million subscribers did. January 2018 was also when the whole Logan Paul Suicide Forest shit happened, so yeah, that wasn't YouTube's greatest month at all. Matt's What It is a former YouTuber who did comedy and men's fitness videos, although what he was mainly known for is causing the third Adpocalypse. In 2019, he uploaded a video titled YouTube is facilitating the sexual exploitation of children, and it's being monetized. In the video, he reveals a hidden side to YouTube where people would share what's essentially softcore child exploitation and pornography. The videos would often feature children in slightly provocative but innocent-seeming situations, like doing handstands and eating popsicles. Until you look at the view counts and the comments and it becomes clear that they're anything but innocent. Matt's video on this topic got over 4 million views, and he called for his viewers to contact various companies to pull their ads from these videos. YouTube came in and responded by deleting over 400 channels, disabling comments on millions of videos, and sometimes even reporting users to law enforcement. Despite this, companies such as Disney, Hasbro, Epic Games, and AT&T began pulling ads from YouTube as a whole yet again, resulting in a third Adpocalypse. Matt's approach to the situation was widely criticized among his fellow content creators, stating that while he definitely had good intentions and these videos definitely should have been taken down, many felt that it was the wrong approach to the situation, as he rushed in kind of recklessly and made false claims like that YouTube has done nothing to stop the promotion of this content. Many also felt that he could have just contacted YouTube privately, or really done anything to prevent what happened from happening. People also began looking at Matt's old videos, and yeah, let's just say he wasn't exactly the least pedophilic person on the planet. Last but not least, we have the fourth, and let's face it, probably not final Adpocalypse, which was the Vox situation. This started with the conflict between conservative talk show host Steven Crowder and Vox reporter Carlos Maza. Maza uploaded the video to Twitter of the several times Crowder would insult him based on things like his sexuality and ethnicity. Maza then received harassment from Crowder's fans and responded by calling out YouTube, Crowder's main platform for content creation, for not enforcing their policy on harassment and bullying. YouTube responded by saying that while his opinions may be deeply offensive, they don't technically violate their policies, and therefore Steven Crowder was allowed to stay on YouTube, since he did not instruct his fans to harass Mazza. All they really did to punish him is demonetization until he takes down links to his homophobic t-shirts. The whole controversy was obviously not good publicity for YouTube, and advertisers were once again ready to pull away from the platform. YouTube responded by saying they were updating their policy on hate speech and harassment, effectively demonetizing tons of accounts such as Black Pigeon Speaks, The Golden One, and Crowder himself. Three other channels were terminated entirely, with one of them being Norwegian musician and convicted felon Varg Vikernes, also known as Burzum. This of course led YouTube being criticized for having anti-conservative biases right after they were just accused of having pro-conservative biases. A couple months later, YouTube tightened their policies on harassment even further. While this did work to prevent creators from being harassed, it also had some adverse effects, like deleting certain videos that weren't really harassment. Like, for example, the Leafy Is Here content cop, which really wasn't so much harassment as it was the exact opposite, being the exposure of a known harasser. Also, personally, I think Onision being on YouTube since 2006 and not getting banned is kind of weird. And thus concludes Tier 3 of the YouTube iceberg. And I gotta say, what a trip. This tier has been incredibly long. I think alone it's over 2 hours long, and it's only the second longest tier. I mentioned this in the comment section of the last video, but after this whole series is done, I plan on making an honorable mentions bonus video type thing, going over the honorable mentions section of this Google Doc for the iceberg, as well as some things I personally think are missing. Feel free to leave some things in the comment section that the iceberg is missing, and I might go over them in the honorable mentions video. This project is somehow a bit more daunting than I was expecting it to be, but hey, I'm having a lot of fun making it, and I hope you're having a lot of fun watching it. If you're starting to get sick of how well known the stuff I'm talking about is, just give me a bit. There's like 13 tiers. Anyways, yeah, that's pretty much all I have to say. Thanks to Pot of Plant for making the list, and thank you for watching. Goodbye.